Is your medication helping or hurting you? Find out at drugsafetynews.com.
So, Farron, of course, folks are well aware that we had the Iowa caucuses this week. And we had some surprises, I guess, and it certainly on both arguably on the Republican side and arguably on the Democratic side. I mean, I guess it depends on how far back in time you go in terms of surprises. But let's start with the Republicans. Ted Cruz came in first. I don't know that this is going to be a surprise to anybody at this point. Ted Cruz came in first with 27.6% of the vote. Donald Trump came in second with 24.3%. Marco Rubio third with 23.1%. Then a big drop off to Ben Carson at 9.3%. And surprisingly, you had Jeb Bush actually in double digits. He was at 2.8%. And I say that, of course, because I think that if we were talking about even 7 months ago, the idea that Jeb Bush would not have come in first, the idea that Donald Trump would have come in a close second would be completely unheard of. The idea that Ted Cruz would come in first would be a big surprise for the conventional wisdom. And, of course, to a certain extent, you and I have been saying this stuff for months because we understand the Republican Party, frankly, more than I think even maybe the Republican Party does.
Well, the Republican Party hasn't been paying attention to what they've allowed themselves to become, which is a party of people like Ted Cruz and Donald Trump. And, you know, Rubio's third place finish there, I think, was the one thing that really kind of shocked everybody, especially because his concession speech sounded more like a victory speech. But Rubio's third place finish, I didn't expect him to do this well. And he's an odd candidate because he's playing both sides and he's doing a decent enough job of it. But he is claiming to not be establishment and yet not be Tea Party when he is probably one of the most establishment and one of the most Tea Partiers that's out there right now. So I don't know if he's suffering through an identity crisis as to what kind of Republican he wants to be. But even if that's the case, it seems to be working out very well for him. And you know, pulling in over 20% when you have two other guys who also got over 20%, that is a very good showing for Marco Rubio. And you know, Ted Cruz, as we've said in the past, getting first place, he is a real danger. But Trump and Rubio, also right there with him. Beyond those three, I don't see anyone else as a real threat at this point.
Well, you know, I mean, it's interesting because, Marco Rubio was extremely celebratory for a third place finish. And it's my opinion that this is close to his peak, frankly. And, you know, I think we're going to see over the course, and we have seen, of course, this week as Trump and Cruz set their sights on him. And, of course, the New Hampshire primary is coming up in a couple of days on Tuesday of this coming week. But Rubio, of course, will maybe he'll come in third. Maybe he'll come in second. It's not inconceivable he could come in fourth. You know, you still have guys like John Kasich, where was sort of built for New Hampshire. Chris Christie, I doubt it, but it's not inconceivable that he could do well in this state. But the bottom line is the Republican Party still has a major problem. And, you know, Donald Trump supporters are far more likely to go to a Ted Cruz than they would a Marco Rubio. Ted Cruz supporters far more likely to go to a Donald Trump than a Marco Rubio. And then when you're talking about Ben Carson, who in Iowa got 10% of the vote, his followers are just as likely to go to Cruz or Trump as they are to Rubio. So I just don't know where these votes come from. And so, yes, there is it's quite possible that Marco Rubio becomes the establishment figure. But one thing that we learned from 2012, Farron, is that the calculations as to when people drop out, particularly in the Republican race, have been fundamentally altered by the amount of money that's sloshing around in these races. Now, it is true that Huckabee dropped out this week, but he had no support really from anyone. And to a certain extent, I'm not convinced now. I mean, it would have been conceivable earlier, but I'm not convinced now that, you know, he just becomes a surrogate for Donald Trump. Trump had some very warm words for him, and certainly Mike Huckabee is the type of guy who has a feel of wanting to be around a billionaire businessman, if you know what I mean. And so, look, you've got people like Chris Christie, who would normally be out of the race by now, but they have benefactors who like the message they're bringing. In Christie's case, it's the idea of cutting Social Security. There are billionaires out there who might say, you know what, I want to hear Rick Santorum continue to talk about his, you know, Christian conservatism. Rand Paul, he may want to stay in there for a while. Who knows? I mean, so the bottom line is there's so much money sloshing around that it's going to be harder for the Republican Party to consolidate. And that's what they want to do. They want to consolidate the establishment support behind Marco Rubio, but it may be very difficult to do. Jeb Bush still has a ton of money out there, and he may be thinking about, I want to save some face. I don't want to go out in the days before New Hampshire, the days after New Hampshire, as a total loser. He may have convinced himself that he can somehow pick up some points somewhere. So this is going to be very difficult for the Republican Party going forward. I don't think it's going to be this coalescing around an establishment figure that some in the conventional and the mainstream media and the Beltway groupthink want us to believe. But I guess time will tell. We've got this this primary in New Hampshire, and I have a feeling we'll have a better sense of what will happen after that day.